Hello, welcome everyone. Today I'm so pleased to be hosting an interview with a working mom that I got the pleasure to know her in one of her coaching sessions. And before we joined an event together. And I'm so happy to have Susanna Borek join me today to speak about her experience as a mom and also how she is. Tell us more about juggling being a PhD researcher, working, and also coaching people in communication. She has three certificates around communication, positive intelligence, and organizations relationships coaching. And yeah, so let me welcome her. And if you are watching, let us know in the comment, or also if you join in the replay, just let us know. Hello, Susanna.
Hello, Sarah. So nice to be
How
here.
are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm so excited to have this interview with you. Yeah, I've been
Yeah, let's
looking
start.
forward to have you as a guest here.
This is my pleasure.
Tell us more about yourself, I mean your work, how many kids you have, and if there had been any change between before kids and after kids in your career. Yeah, just brief introduction.
Okay, I have two kids. One is almost 5, and the other one is just about to turn 1 year. The difference between in my career before kids and after kids. Well, the first kid I had in the Netherlands, and there I didn't see any difference. I just with my whole heart I love the system that they have in the Netherlands. I'm originally from Poland, so both kids I'm having as an expat, so it's totally different and a new experience the first time and now the second time where I live in Germany. In Germany, there is way less support for working females, and then when there is no support coming from the system, from the government or the organization, well, it has to be compensated by the family. So in this case, I would also see that there is very little impact on my career from my kids, and this is mostly because of my partner and how he helps me. Well, how he actually doesn't help, how we handle the situation together, right? We have those kids together.
There is the switch in feeling that here you don't get as much support, I mean, law-wise, or how is it? I mean, can you tell us more about the support, the difference, how in Germany it's not as in Netherlands?
Of course, it's a lot about your own preferences, but for me, the Dutch system is just, the perfect fit. It's just normal that females are having kids and having a career. There are still some inequalities that Dutch people are fighting for. But in general, the whole time when you're out of your work is just 4 months. It's a month before giving birth and 3 months afterwards. And normally, this 4 months at the same time, like some Dutch people are taking such a long holidays once in a while, or you can get ill, or you need, to take care of someone in your family, and you're also out for 2 months sometimes. So this is just a normal life event. It's easy to then compensate for you for just 4 months, so you are not really out of any flow, anything. But on top of that, like, so I really like that the maternity leave is very short. The other aspect is that you have there is no problem of getting daycare. So there is a place for every kid this is supported by the government as well. So those 3 months old babies, they have amazing facilities, you know, like it's way, like all the fancy things that if you go to all those stores with things for the kids, you know, and you say like, oh my God, you know, like you could spend all your savings there. Well, they have it all there, all the mm-hmm. electric swings and, you know, really, really well qualified staff. So that's, and it's normal, everyone does it. Everyone, you know, gives back such a small kid to those facilities. So there is a certain trust.
There is more comfort to go back earlier to work and finding also childcare is not the same as here in Germany, which is a bit very challenging. So why motivated? What motivated you to join here in Germany in terms of your career? I mean, why did you move to Germany? What did you start doing once you moved here?
So I moved to Germany because my husband found a position in Heidelberg. So we first moved to Heidelberg, and then I found, while looking in for the position in Germany, I didn't like Heidelberg that much. I'm a big city person. So then we decided to move to Berlin, and I got a job here. So that's why we moved here. In science, back then I was just starting my adventure with coaching. So then science was my full-time position. And it's normal, like with science, you just move every new job. It's good for your CV, it's good for your experience to explore different countries, different systems, different groups, different cultures. So that was the reason to move. Also, I'm coming from Poland, Germany. It is like a gold standard for us. You know, everyone always compares how amazing it is in Germany. And there is, I don't know if other fields as well, but in biomedical research, we always say that Germany has this amazing offer for, you know, for parental leave. So we even have a joke that if someone wants to have kids in academia, they go to Germany.
Oh, okay.
And well, I'm surprised.
you didn't
that wouldn't be my top recommendation.
How has been so far your experience? Tell us more about what you are doing in research apart from communication coaching. Then we speak about the communication thing.
Okay. From the background, I finished biotechnology, although the studies were actually more like molecular biology. So I studied really all the web lab techniques. I'm very lab oriented. And when I moved to Netherlands, there I started my first PhD. And there I mostly worked in a wet lab for 2 years. And then I slowly started moving to the data analysis, as that was one of the top departments for human genetics worldwide. This is really top place. And there, of course, you produce your data and then you want to analyze it. So then I was, that was my first switch, my actually first little career switch from the wet lab to the dry lab, as we call it. And then I started analyzing the data. And normally in science, there is this division, you either do this or that. And there is very little communication between those two. So those people who analyze the data have very little experience or knowledge about experimental part,
okay,
and vice versa. So often when we design experiments, we don't think how we will analyze it. Mm. So then it's a huge challenge statistic-wise, or sample sizes, or how you combine your controls with your cases and those stuff. And I actually loved both. I've sensed and I've talked with some people that there is actually a big need to have both. And that's where I started to position myself. And that's how I found another position in Berlin, looking into like kind of combining both. So like obtaining molecular data here in Berlin from patients with inflammatory bowel disease. This is autoinflammatory disease. And then getting those samples and analyzing them. So nice. Again, like combining nice. Two.
Yeah, you are in a similar orientation as me in the data world.
I'm really
challenging because especially as when you say it's like you have to take care of the, I mean, they don't consider that there will be afterward analysis. So you have to clean the data and find a way to get value from it. But yeah, it's at the same time fulfilling, I think, when you do that.
In biomedical research, there is also an aspect of we often have a human data, and this is never a clean data. You know, just you get the patients that just agree to participate in a study, and that's often far away from your perfect random sampling that you would had, or the numbers never reach the one that you wanted, or just, you know, kind of every sample is unique, and then when you process them in the lab, some of them fail, and then you end up with what you end up. So you still, sometimes with the best intentions and knowledge, it's still human data is still very challenging to analyze.
Yeah, I understand that. That's really good that you are pushing for this challenge. What would be your advice for a mom who is a first-time mom, like pursuing her career in research? What challenges she may face, and like from your experiences, what do you think helped you, and would love to share with a mom pursuing her career in research here in Germany?
I would say, well, don't let other people define you. If you, you know, if I truly believe if someone wants to achieve something, there is no way of stopping that person. And this is all about really being honest what you want. Because there is nothing, you know, like, I don't like to stay home with kids. And I think there is way more people, way more females who doesn't like that. But this is very difficult to say out loud on a social level, on a cultural level. Even in Germany, there is still expectations from females that they will be taking care of little humans. And yeah, like if this is not what you want to do, then be very open with it first with yourself, then with your partner. And I would even advise to discuss that before you have kids. But even if it changes, you know, like you thought it would be different, and then it's different than you thought, because
I don't know,
you've looked on the Instagram and you thought, oh, it's so easy, you know, kid here juggling that there, and then I don't know, I cannot do that. When I'm working, I cannot have my kids around me. I need to focus. I can't.
Yeah.
So, you know, like being really open and honest about what you can do, how you want to do it, and give yourself permission to be human. Like not to be like a super and human, not to be like I have to be like a super like Wonder Woman, you know, to do that. No, you don't. Like you can be just yourself, and this is totally fine and enough. And yeah, kids, of course, the small kids, I don't know, they learn a lot. But at this age, if someone else is taking care of them, it's fine. You can offer them even more when they grow up a little bit, and then you tell them what you know, how your career is, how you fought for yourself, right? How you
You can even tell them when they are small. I really like when you consider a child that he understands, because I myself is keep being every day surprised at how my son understands things, really.
Everything, sometimes, right?
Yeah, so it's nice that when we forget about this is small, doesn't understand, and say that I'm doing this because I love this, I do this, it makes me happier. And so, yeah, I mean, I just interrupted you, but it was for saying, like, communicate with them, I mean, even earlier. I think you do that because we already spoke about this.
Yeah, we did, yeah.
Yeah, and how they understand everything. The moment when they are with you, like speaking with them, and then when they are in childcare, then just be sure and trust the childcare people to take them off them.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you, I know you are working, so you have like you are also a communication coach.
Mm-hmm.
Working in the research, what's the difference between both? Because I feel that when you are in research, it's different somehow, and there is different challenges. So if you can just tell us more a little bit in the research side, what challenges can be there, and
Well, in my experience, I can of course only talk about my experience.
Of course.
It is not normal to be in a research and have family. That both partners are in research and have families. That there is very little flexibility, very little understanding towards that. So I find a lot of discrimination because of your sex, because that's on a female. They say they understand. And that's what I've heard a lot. No, of course, we know you have a small kid. Of course, we know. But the expectations are the same as if I could work, I don't know, 60 hours a week, which is way more than the contract that I signed. B, it's just not feasible. So there is, and it's very tiring. I need to constantly remind them, well, that's the working hours I've signed for, and that's hours I'm working. So that's the amount of work I can produce. And B, I have a small kid. So if you schedule a meeting, you know, at 5 p.m., while my kita is closed, right? So once in a while, I can ask my husband to, you know, to take care of both of them at that time. But that's, you know, that's the time where I just want to spend time with my family. You know, I can maybe catch up something in the evening if there is a deadline, or occasionally, you know, but expecting every week that you will be available at certain time, that is just not supported by the government, by the institution. I mean, like, the institution could hire a nanny or something, right? But if they don't do that and expecting you to be there, it's just, yeah.
Just doesn't make sense. Unfair.
and you know, with coaching, I'm a freelancer, so I'm my own boss. So
thank you for telling us. So speaking, you have to speak more about yourself when you are in research and ask for what reminds. Speak up.
Yep.
Because the expectations are a bit different than thank you.
And sadly, you know, like, if you ask around, everyone says, like, oh no, like, that's exactly why I don't want to have kids, you know, like, kids will kill my career. And yeah, you can see that. I definitely, in Germany, I do look as a country who is like a killer of female careers. Sadly.
Yeah. Okay.
And if not, the compensation is really, you know, on you and your partner. And I mean, as I said at the beginning, I really believe whatever you want, you can achieve. But the price that you need to pay, meaning, you know, how often you have to go and fight and talk with them. Yeah, it's a bit tiring at some point.
Okay. I feel your pain. And so I can only appreciate you more for holding on. Doing it even with family, and I guess that since you face such challenges in research, your communication coaching certificates and so positive intelligence and dealing with conflicts and so really is really helping you in this.
Right, it's actually started from there. I need to deal with a lot of conflicts. At some point that I didn't even know there was a conflict, because that was not a vocabulary that was allowed to be used. Not even saying it's an issue or a problem. At best, maybe miscommunication. And then, you know, I start self-educating myself, just reading books, googling. And then you're like, I guess this is called slightly different in books. And then you start talking with other people, and then you see, oh, I'm not alone. This is a bigger problem what I'm experiencing. And then, you know, I try to help. In general, that's why I started my scientific career. I wanted to help people.
Mm.
And then, yeah, I started helping my peers. And I just wanted to do it more skillfully. So that's how I found my way with coaching. And then when I found coaching, you know, I had like a big aha moment of, oh my God, here I'm actually literally with every session, I'm helping someone. You know, with the research, you aim, oh yeah, maybe in 5 years, there will be something gained within a field. Maybe, yeah. You know, with my whole career, I can change something. And here with every session, you know, you work with a real breathing human being and their problems. And when you have a capacity to help them, to support them, to, you know, to change something for them, it's so empowering and so unbelievable.
Yeah.
So that's how I started coaching. And then communication. I've been always crazy about communication. So that was a little bit like a very natural and organic direction for me. Also because, you know, they ask you to find a niche and then you look for something that there is not that many other coaching doing. And then, yeah, it sounded like a perfect fit for me. And that's how it feels for now.
Yeah. What certificates do you have? I mean, in coaching, there is three. What are they?
Yeah.
How are you serving people with them?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So first, from the beginning, I wanted to work with groups. But when I was looking for the training for myself, I met a very smart person, and that person, after talking with me and my career and what type of coach I want to be and, you know, my aspirations, he literally told me, you know what, like, before you start with the groups, you should learn how to work with people. And then I should first start with like this one-on-one approach. I got very offended. I was like, I don't know how to talk with people. Like, yeah. I'm working with people every day. What? And then, but I trusted him, you know? I was like, okay, well, but he's been through that. He's way more experienced. So I gave it a try. And then from the first hour of the one-on-one coaching training, I was like, that's what he meant. Okay, well, that's... And now I would say, you know, in science, you work next to each other, but you don't really work with people.
Mm. Okay.
So for me, the one-on-one was a natural step just to learn. And then I did it with co-active model, so it's called. So it's like co and active for like being and acting, to combine both like emotional status, stage, and the action, you know, doing something about everything. And from this, I did my certification. And while doing a certification, you can get accredited by International Coaching Federation. And that's what I did.
Mm.
You need for that, you know, like you need a certification program. You need 100 coaching hours minimum. And to pass a ethics test. There is a code of ethics for coaches, and it's 3 hours long test. I thought I would die in the middle of that, but I managed.
And you were doing this while you are working on your
while I was working,
having two kids,
having one kid. I started with one kid, and then when I finished that, I started my group training, which is organization and relationship system coaching. And then I started when I was pregnant with my second kid. And I did that during my pregnancy. And now I will start certification also from that. I can only apply in April because they don't have that many openings.
Mm.
And you need to have certain number of teams that you work with. So yeah, I first needed to finish my maternity leave. I'm now in the process of hiring a teams. For that, till April, I have still some time. And in the meantime, I did positive intelligence training. And in January, I will finish my certification from positive intelligence. So, and the positive intelligence is a nice bridge between, like, individual, the coactive, and ORSC, the group one. You can apply it in both scenarios. And I love it because it has a little bit more structure. So for some people who are a little bit more reluctant to the coaching vocabulary, or are a little bit more like I was, you know, very rational, very head oriented, very logical, this is just like a easier step to take. Just,
yeah,
you know, instead of going fully to, okay, let's explore your body, your emotions, which are very important, then it's like there is a little like bridging step. I know you did the positive intelligence training, so you know a little bit about saboteurs and SAGE, and that's just, you know, like a middle step for most of the people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really great to be. I love actually like that mix that you did, and how you use that coaching to get results right away and see the difference that you are making, because in research it's not the case. That's really great. Now I have a question for you about communication. Mm-hmm. Because especially as a first-time moms, many of us face the issue of when we become moms, we tend to put everything on us, mm-hmm. like the expectations from ourselves and of others, and then also the criticism, and so all these things, I think, participate in making it harder for ourselves to communicate. And I know that one of the things that you do help your clients with is self-communication, and can you share with us the role that does self-communication play in this, like mm-hmm. with what I describe it, mm-hmm. and how does the way we communicate with ourselves impact the way we communicate with others?
Mm-hmm. So with all the clients I work on the communication, because I believe communication is the key for whatever we desire to achieve, any of our, you know, goals, career-wise, life-wise, family-wise, kids-wise, it's all at the bottom level, that's just communication. And to be able to communicate well with others, we need to start with communicating well with ourselves. And I see that process on three levels. It starts with self-listening. So you really need to listen very well to yourself, to your mind, but also to your body, you know, so to your needs, to your limiting beliefs. Do I have limiting beliefs? How they are stopping me? And what I'm really saying to myself, you know, really listen to that. And I am often using a metaphor of a best friend. Like, imagine you are not talking to yourself, but to your best friend. Question every thought you have and ask yourself, would you ever dare to say it to your best friend? And I can guarantee you that most of them you wouldn't say to even your worst enemy. And this is how we treat ourselves. So that reflects on a second stage, which is self-trust. You know, how would you trust yourself when you dare to say to yourself, you're not good enough, you're not worth it, it's your fault, you know, or like there is a promise you gave to yourself and you haven't kept it? You know, and this is years long, and we all do that. Doesn't matter if we are female or male, we all do that to ourselves. And the last part is, you know, when you listen to yourself, you know your needs, you know what's important for you. That, you know, when you start doing that, then you build self-trust. And then when you build self-trust, that's the opening window to build self-confidence. So let's imagine, you know, you are in a very stressful situation with your boss. You know, he oversteps, he suggested a meeting when, you know, you should just take, like, right now leave for your kid to pick up from Kita, and you have to tell him you can't, but he just said you must go there. You know, super stressful situation, and you don't know what to do. you agree, then, you know, you leave the room crying, you ask your best friend, what could I do? Imagine you could do it with yourself internally in that moment. Just ask my, like, be yourself best friend. And that's how you build self-confidence, you know? You trust yourself that you can say no, that this is fine, because you know your needs, because you know what you deserve, you know who you are, you know your limits, and you love yourself, you know?
Yeah.
You deserve that. You fully gave yourself that permission, and that builds self-confidence. And this is a circular process that when you practice, builds up and builds up and builds up. And when you're able to do it with yourself, like all of it three together, then I called it self-communication, then you know how to communicate to others, because, again, you know what you need. You know your limits. You listen to your body. You listen to your mind. You know what to reply, you know, and you build upon that when you communicate with other people.
Yeah. Yeah, this is really important. I can say, the first, being your best friend. I really love this sentences, and to summarize, how is it like about self-communication? Maybe it's being about being your best friend, and always, as you said, think if you would say it to a best friend. It's really like we can offer our friends, like, don't say, but to ourselves, no, we are not our best friend.
Yeah, just, you know, imagine you just lost your job and you're down, you're calling your friend. Just imagine that she will say to you, you loser, of course you lost it. Will she even be your best? Like, would you trust her? You know, like, end that relationship very fast. And the thing is, you can't end relationship with yourself. It's there, but you can use it to your benefit, you know? So you can be that person to yourself saying, oh, they're lost, you know? Good for you. Now you will find a better job because you deserve that, you know? It's your right to have it.
Yeah.
And you have so much to offer. So before you know, there will be opportunity on opportunity. So yay, good for you. They made it just, you know, a favor.
yeah, it's true. How do you, because the thing is, when, especially on the first, like, months and so of being a mom, it's like we go over that wheel of the motherhood, yeah. And so when we don't stop to like really think and be with ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Any tip you have for this case?
Yeah. When was the last time you take yourself out for a coffee? When was the last time you actually invited yourself for a date? For a, you know, surprise self-care. As you would go for your best friend, I don't know, to get your nails done, or for a coffee, for a drink, for a dinner. Just to talk and, you know, support each other, be nice to each other. When was the last time you did it to yourself? And I think this is the first step.
Being aware
and just inviting yourself for a date. I do that. This is, you know, this is one part of my self-care. Mm. You know, there is a good diet, sleep, exercise, and there is a part where I just invite myself for a coffee, for a walk, and I really listen. What do I need? What is missing? What do I need more? And whatever I hear, I try not to judge. With time, it gets easier. You know, I try to really look at myself and give myself so much empathy and love as only I can, but this is just a practice.
Yeah, by practice it becomes better. But the first step is, as you said, yeah, thank you for this.
And maybe last thing to add on that, you know, when you feel, oh, be about my kid or about that, I can't afford it. I always give a metaphor of first aid. You know, when there is an accident, do you know what is the first thing you need to do before you can help anyone?
Put the oxygen on yourself. Is it this one?
Yeah, You first, that's like the airplane where with the air mask.
Something similar.
But if there is a real accident, the first thing you do, you make sure you are safe. And then you call the ambulance or whatever, or you assess what you can do for the other person. But first, you need to be safe, because if you are not safe, then there will be not one person but two to, you know, get help.
Yeah.
So this is the rule number one. First you. If you want best for your kid, you go first, really. Like, without you, the kid is not getting, without a happy mom, kid is not getting any happiness.
Mm.
They learn from us, you know? So set them a good example of taking care of yourself, being happy, trusting yourself, being confident and knowing your value. And there are so many ways now in the 21st century to do that, either with coaching, like I help others, either with therapy. There are so many workshops, you know, it's support groups.
Or with my membership.
Thriving moms.
Yeah, thriving moms.
Exactly. Whatever, you know, we are thriving people, right?
Exactly. If you look, you find. Yeah. Thank you so much for this. How can people connect with you, with your coaching? What do you want to say, like, best words, and how to connect with you?
We can connect with me on LinkedIn for sure. We can leave it in the comments, just the link to my LinkedIn. You can write me an email. It's just Zuzanna@fierceunicorn.eu. My freelancing is called Fierce Unicorn. I also have my website.
I will share it. Okay, LinkedIn and your website, Zenso. Thank you so much, Zuzanna, for joining me today.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
I hope to invite you once for a workshop with my members also.
That would be my pleasure.
Time went so fast with you. I would have loved to ask you more, because communication is really important.
But
we will use what you get to share with us today. Thank you so much, and goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.